like to welcome us to the family session convened by the Family Law Committee, one of the youngest committees for which I will moderate this session. Several international, regional and domestic pieces of legislation protect the family as a basic unit of society. But it is the case that in the area of policy, programming and litigation, the required protection does not always translate. In this session, we will deliberate by way first of insertion or immersion into what the various jurisdictions are experiencing with regard to the challenges to the protection of the family, and then in the second phase of our engagement, after dialoguing with our panelists, we will have a presentation on the international and regional protections of the family that are in the making, so that we may build the necessary awareness to influence our legislators, our diplomats, and policymakers back at home. So I'd like to invite our two panelists and later our discussant to the podium. I'll start with Senior Counsel Charles Kajava. Welcome. And Dr. Shali Magas, you're welcome. You should occupy the business beside the table. Exactly. Now, I will introduce them both in one go, and then we will start the conversation. Now, Senior Counsel Charles Kajama is an advocate of the High Court of Kenya. And for some reason, he was the inaugural chair of the Law Society of Kenya, Nairobi branch, as well as the Law Society of Kenya caucus of branch chairs. He is a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators, a certified professional mediator, a certified secretary, and a certified accountant. He is the current chair of the Nairobi Legal Awards Trust, an organization founded by the Law Society of Kenya Nairobi to promote and recognize legal excellence among lawyers, law firms, and legal departments. He's the current chair of the Kenya Christian Professionals Forum, which brings together professionals from various Christian denominations to champion family values. He's also the vice chair of the Africa Christian Professionals Forum. We need to clap for Mr. Charles Kajama. Our second panelist is Dr. Shirley Magazi, who is an advocate in training and has been actively working on the question of ethical human rights and the protection of the integrity of the Namibian Constitution. To date, she has successfully advocated for laws protecting the sanctity of life, laws protecting the dignity of marriage, and laws protecting the moral development and integrity of children in Namibia. She is passionate about human rights law and constitutional law, and is a big proponent of an ethical and value-based approach to human rights, which upholds and protects morality. Dr. Shirley Magazi, as I said earlier, is an advocate in training, and would be joining the bar in the next few years. Welcome, Dr. Shari. So as I indicated earlier, we will listen to our panelists and then dialogue with them. They will do 15 minutes each. We will then dialogue with them, and after we will walk the journey through the proposed steps towards protecting the family within international instruments. So we will start with Dr. Shelley Magazi, who will share the Namibian experience. How are they experiencing the challenges towards the family? Welcome, Dr.
Good afternoon to everyone, and particular to our chairperson. Thank you very much for having me here at the African Bar Association. And to our audience this afternoon, thank you very much for being part of this session. We trust that we will have very informative discussions this afternoon. Allow me to share with you a case study of Namibia, and it will take in the form of lessons learned in protecting, promoting, as well as preserving the Namibian family. I will not take much time, so let me immediately just go into my presentation for this afternoon. In recent years, Namibia has been experiencing a proliferation of threats targeting to destabilize the family as the natural and fundamental unit of society in the nation of Namibia. This experience of Namibia is evidently not unique to us, but is increasingly becoming a new norm on the African continent. Though families are conferred the rights to protection in most, if not all, African countries, there are very few, if at all, any local legal instruments that give effect to the protection of families. Namibia is no exception. This is very unfortunate, given the critical role that families play in sustainable economic, political, religious, cultural, moral, and social impact in any given nation. Today, I would like to accentuate the important role that African lawyers could play in protecting, promoting, and preserving the African family as a natural and fundamental unit of society on the African continent. My approach will be to extract lessons learned from Namibia based on a recent Supreme Court ruling in the Degasha case that ruled that Namibia, as an independent and sovereign nation, is obligated to recognize same-sex spouses lawfully married in other jurisdictions. This is despite the fact that Namibia does not recognize same-sex marriages. As is expected in a true African country, this ruling stirred an uproar in the nation of Namibia by the majority of the Namibian people, rejecting the ruling and calling for legislation that would explicitly stipulate that same-sex marriages in Namibia is prohibited and therefore not recognized. The events that led to an act of parliament to contradict the Supreme Court ruling that ruled that Namibia is to recognize same-sex marriages lawfully conducted or concluded in other jurisdictions, was anchored on the following legal framework. First and foremost, the Namibian Constitution as a supreme law in Namibia. And from there, I would like to extract two principles, and that's the protection of human rights. And then secondly, the separation of power. Firstly, under human rights protection, the Namibian Constitution imposes limitations to the fundamental rights and freedoms conferred in Chapter 3 of the Namibian Constitution in the interest of the sovereignty and integrity of Namibia, national security, public order, decency, or morality. In particular, looking at the family rights that is conferred in our constitution, the natural progression of founding a family in Namibia according to the Namibian constitution is rooted in the institution of marriage. Marriage between a man and a woman of full age, without limitation to ethnicity, race, religion, color, creed, social or economic status. And I assume that that would be the case in most of the African countries. It is important to note at this particular juncture that Namibia does not recognize the provision of sexual orientation as a ground in our constitution. The second principle is taken from the separation of power. The Namibian Constitution makes provision to an act of parliament to contradict any Supreme Court ruling. Secondly, courts do not have legislative power and can therefore not make laws, and thus legislative power is conferred to the parliament to make laws. Based on this Namibian Constitution as the Supreme Court or supreme law in Namibia, that was the anchor upon which everything else flowed from. Secondly, we looked at the international law, and in particular, we looked at the African Charter with particular interest on Article 18, 22, 27, as well as 29, that stipulates that the state shall assist the family, which is a custodian of morals and traditional values recognized by the community, in order to preserve and strengthen positive African cultural values in their relations and with other members of society, in the spirit of tolerance, dialogue, consultation, and in general to contribute to the promotion of the moral well-being of African society. We also looked at our customary laws, and in Namibia there is no customary practice that recognizes same-sex relationships as marriages. On the contrary, the moral, religious, and traditional values of our cultures in Namibia protect the Namibian family from any unnatural practice and behavior that poses as a threat to the family as the natural unit. And I will emphasize natural unit. Fourthly, we also looked at common law. And the common law principle on sodomy prohibits practices between two men that is ordinarily practiced in same-sex relationships between men. And then finally, we looked at our statutory law. And unfortunately, for over the past 20 years, Namibia failed to introduce any legislation that would give effect to the judicial precedents that Namibia has been holding on and relied upon for many years, that clearly said that Namibia does not recognize same-sex marriages. This vacuum of no legislation necessitated that the lawmakers would then enact a law that protects family by amending the Marriage Act to clarify the term spouse in the Marriage Act. The events that took place in Namibia following the Supreme Court ruling and in the manner that they took place and with the promotion and motivation to protect families in Namibia, one can extract the following lessons that I would briefly want to share with you. First of all, the rule of law dictates that the judiciary should refrain from practices that may bring the judiciary in disrepute. Unfortunately, the Supreme Court ruling in the Degashi case brought in disrepute the integrity and the independence of our courts by them overlooking the provisions of the Namibian Constitution and the Namibian customary laws in their decision making. Secondly, the role of legal practitioners in aiding the courts to arrive to sound, well-researched decisions grounded within the legal framework of their jurisdictions cannot be overemphasized. This requires obviously extensive and objective research, and more so a thorough understanding of national laws and international instruments that support national laws and promote our customary laws. Thirdly, the promotion of customary laws is paramount in protecting, promoting, and preserving the African family. Fourthly, the legal profession has an important role in upholding the constitutions and laws of our respective countries on this continent, which guarantees the protection of the family as the natural and fundamental unit of society founded on marriage between a man and a woman, the right to life, and the dignity of the human person, while emphasizing the need to also support vulnerable African families, namely single-parented households, child-headed families, grandparents caring for their children, and multi-generational families. Fifthly, through sound legal advice to governments during policy formulation and the lawmaking process, legal practitioners have an opportunity to actively and diligently lead the discussion of safeguarding the African family from policies and laws that will deconstruct and thereby undermining our cultural values. Very important is the role that academic institutions can play in this regard by strengthening the training of lawyers on family law based on the family as a custodian of moral values and African values, promoting, protecting, and preserving the sanctity of natural marriage between a man and a woman as the cornerstone of the African family. The judiciary has an obligation to ensure that court judgments remain true to the ethos and identity of the people, ensuring that the interpretation and application of national laws reflect the society that they serve, the values, opinions, social and historical background of the people. The legal profession should actively uphold the rule of law at all costs, even if it is unpopular to the expectations of countries providing aid to Africa. And finally, there is an obligation that we all have to protect the sovereignty and integrity of our African nations from imperialistic pressure through neo-colonialism. I thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Magazi, for that presentation. As you can see, distinguished colleagues, it could be the case that the family law we learned in school might not be very sufficient for the challenges that the family is facing now. We might have to upgrade, so to say. I'd like now to invite Senior Counsel Charles Kanyama to share with us the Kenyan experience. Welcome.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us in this session. It's a very interesting session on matters touching on family, family values, and family protection. I'm going to talk about a case study of Kenya and East Africa in general. But before that, I want to go to the background and talk about family and family values so that we can lay a good background of this topic. And I'd like to appreciate my colleague, Dr. Magazi, who's done a good job in explaining some of the challenges that the family is facing. So I'm going to divide this presentation into four parts. First is I have dealt with the question of concepts and definition of terms. It seems self-evident, but it's something that is worth exploring. I've also dealt with the question of the key legal instruments on marriage and family. And of course, you know that for each of our different jurisdictions, matters of family are often considered matters of personal law that are jurisdiction-specific. And even within each jurisdiction, we tend to have different personal law systems about marriage and the family. And so sometimes it seems that everyone has his own culture, his own tradition, his own religion, his own views, or his own practices on family. What are the common elements in these personal laws? And are there any laws at the international stage that deal with matters of family? Then number three, I'll deal with the case study of Kenya on family protection and promotion. And I'll also deal with the other East African countries briefly. And then I'll give a conclusion on the way forward. So that is just a quick summary of what this presentation is covering. And there are many documents that talk about the family without defining the family, that is legal documents. If you go to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights of 1948, there's a whole article on the family. The International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights is an article on the family. The Economic and Social Covenant, Social and Cultural Covenant, also of 1966, there are like two or three articles on the family. The African Charter of Human and People's Rights has several articles touching on the family. But the family is not really defined, it's taken for granted. In the case of Kenya, we have, like in several countries with modern constitutions, a whole provision also dealing with the family. And most of the constitutional law that deals with the family uses a definition that describes one element of family without really explaining how families look like. And that is the definition that comes from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which says that the family is the natural and fundamental group unit of society. It doesn't say more about the family. How is it made up? What are the relationships between family members? It's almost like taken for granted. In Kenya, we felt that we need to do more than just having a constitution that says we protect and promote the family. And after doing a lot of benchmarking, we found that there are one or two countries in the Hungary that even have a family law that is not just discussing marriage, how to enter marriage, and how to divorce, and how to deal with property and children, but it's discussing the rights of the family. And we thought that this is a good model. We looked at it, and we started by proposing the development of a family promotion and protection policy. We worked with our government. We came up with a document that is awaiting adoption by cabinet. And there is a section definition of terms. And what we realized as we're going through this process of defining what a family is that the definition of family is a bit elusive. It's not completely clear. And there are many kinds of families. So we we realize we need to have different definitions of the nuclear family. There's extended family, sometimes you have single parent families. But then we also wanted to define the natural family, because to be able to protect the family against threats to the family, we need to understand what is that core definition of a family. So all these other kinds of family structures must be reflecting aspects of this natural family definition. And this document is available online. You can actually download it if you type Family Promotion and Protection Policy Kenya. And you'll find the definitions there. But this was something that we found quite interesting. For the purpose of this presentation, I've proposed that the family is a natural institution. It's not artificial. It's not created by the state. It's not like a company. It's natural. It is part of our human nature, founded on marriage. So that marriage is the essential act or the essential relationship that gives rise to a family, that involves a stable partnership of life and love. A stable partnership means there's an element of permanence. It's not something that we enter into transient for a short period of time. And in all cultures that have marriage, you find that the marriage ceremony involves a commitment for life, for a partnership of life. Even when the family breaks down subsequently, it began with an aspiration for permanence. And there have been cultures and jurisdictions which have dealt with the question of whether two people can enter into a marriage for a period of time. Can we marry for 5 or 10 years, both in Christian and Islamic countries? And there were abuses. I remember reading a paper from Iran of abuses in that Islamic country where some people had started getting into marriage for a period of time, for 3 years or 7 years. And eventually the Islamic scholar said, no, this is an abuse of Islamic law about marriage. So that there is a consensus view that when people enter into marriage, it is a relationship that is meant to last permanently, that it is a relationship that involves a partnership of life as well as a partnership of love. And after this definition between human persons, I've discussed about the different types of families. And in Africa, we have the experience of something that we don't find in much of the West, in much of the East, apart from the Arab world, which is prevalence or widespread experience of polygamy. In some of the countries in the West and in the East, they have eliminated polygamy, but in Africa, we have both monogamous and polygamous families. So those are some of the types of families that we find. And then I also thought it was important to reflect on what are the values. What are those valuable things that family is important for? Because for you to protect, you need to know what is it that you're protecting. So what of family has value? And this is an issue that requires much more reflection and discussion. There's already been quite a bit of writing on this issue. And some of those values of the family can be captured if we think about the vision and mission. What does the family exist for? And also we think about the fruits. What are the outputs or what do you expect from family? And some of these key qualities of family that have been identified include stability. The family thrives, or families thrive, when they exist in an element of stability. And there's been a lot of discussion in jurisprudential circles about whether divorce should be made easy, like no-fault divorce. In Kenya right now, a bill has just been published proposing no-fault divorce. Should we allow grounds of divorce like irretrievable breakdown of marriage where you don't need to prove a ground? Should we insist on proving a ground like adultery, desertion, cruelty? What does it mean? So for some, especially legal practitioners who sometimes develop a transactional view of marriage, all obstacles to forming marriage or dissolving marriages should be abolished. But studies have shown that where the culture of the society allows marriages to be entered into and to be dissolved very casually or very easily, something affects the marriage institution, not only for those who are breaking up their marriages, but for everyone else. The studies that have shown that even those couples who are in stable families, their level of contentment or happiness or security in their own families is affected by the experience around them of other families. If others are dissolving their families easier, the thought process, even that person who is in a stable family, do I need to invest more in this family, or maybe even my family will break down? So those are jurisprudential issues. They are issues worth consideration at this African Bar Conference. And then there's, of course, the qualities of exclusivity, and that is why infidelity is something that harms the family. Equality is mentioned in all the various international human rights instruments that talk about the family, equality between the spouses. And there's also an element of hierarchy. In other words, that there's a relationship between two people. Everyone needs to know who leads in this, who leads in the other thing, whose role it is to do this or the other thing. There's an element of mutual care and support, fruitfulness, etc. So we can list several qualities of family and of marriage. And from these qualities, we can then identify the threats to the family. And I've listed several threats, more can be identified, but the key threats include infidelity and divorce, because that affects stability of families in general. Domestic abuse and violence, because sometimes this triggers that lack of mutual care and support. There's also cohabitation, which is kind of like alternative structures that take away the dignity of family. Intimate partner rape and incest. These are disordered sexual relations within the family unit. Desertion and child abandonment, where the family doesn't break up formally, but informally there is some kind of like breakup. Stress, anxiety, and separation, which are situations where the family ceases to provide that kind of like good harbor for the members of the family. Sickness, grief, and death sometimes can also be threats to family. Of course, in many cultures, especially in Christian tradition, the vows for marriage involve in sickness and in health, in good times and in bad. And there's no perfect family. All families go through situations of grief, challenges of one kind or the other. And the idea of reflecting on family promotion and protection is not to build perfect families, it's to empower and equip families so that they can deal with the threats they face and generally be for the good of the members of the family. Because if the family thrives, it is believed that society thrives as well. So the second part of this presentation, I address the question of concepts and definition of terms, is what are the key legal instruments on marriage and family? And I've classified the legal instruments into various kinds. The first are those legal instruments in each country in our domestic laws that deal with marriage and personal laws. Laws regarding children, laws that deal with the formation, the interaction, and disintegration of families. In fact, we notice in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the same formula that the parties to a marriage are entitled to equal rights at the beginning, during, and at the end. There's an assumption that every marriage will come to an end. Hopefully by death of one of the parties at the end, but sometimes it gets disintegrated for other reasons. So there are these personal laws that deal with these matters, and also the laws to do with children, succession. These personal laws is the first source of laws for the family. And all of us, especially those who are lawyers, we go through our studies, we learn about the personal laws of marriage, which tend to be transactional, registration, how to get into this. And lawyers have a role in helping people sometimes go through the processes when they are getting married, with their registration processes. Sometimes it's the pastors, sometimes it is the registrar in the case of civil marriages, and play an active role in cases involving children, maintenance, custody, and so on, and in cases of separation and divorce. So we are very familiar with this first source of laws on family. The second source of laws is human rights laws, both local or domestic municipal laws and international instruments have something to say about human rights, and I've mentioned this, and they talk about the rights of persons in families generally. And there's also a desire to talk about the rights of a family as a unit. And there's been discussion in some academic circles as to whether the family can be a subject of rights. Normally when we talk about human rights, talk about individual rights and freedoms, each individual benefits. And that's the approach that has been taken in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. Every man and woman has the right to found a family with free consent, so that they cannot be compared. And the question is, once they found the family, can the family itself be a subject of rights? In 1983, the Vatican, the Holy See, proposed a charter of family rights, so that the family itself becomes a subject of rights. And when you look at the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, you notice there are certain rights that the members of the family have to economic, social, and cultural well-being. The 1981 African Charter on Human and People's Rights goes a stage further, and it talks about the rights of the members of the family to economic well-being. It talks about the family as a group, because the African Charter fully embraces this third generation of human rights, which are what are called solidarity rights. The first generation, civil and political rights, are at individual level. Second generation, economic, social, and cultural, also generally at individual level. The individual is the subject. But for the African Charter, we recognize, in addition to the first two generations, the third generation of rights. And it is unfortunate that several provisions in the African Charter have not been more discussed or more made as a source of our family law jurisprudence in our various countries in Africa. This is what the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights says in Article 10. State parties to the present covenant recognize that the widest possible protection and assistance should be accorded to the family, which is a natural and fundamental group unit of society. So the family is already beginning to be treated as a subject of rights, particularly for its establishment, and while it is responsible for the care and education of dependent children. Marriage must be entered into with free consent, that one is something we know. And then there's a question of special protection to be accorded to mothers during reasonable period before and after childbirth, and special measures of protection and assistance should be taken on behalf of children. That's the approach of the Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights Covenant. When we move from that covenant, I wanted to say something briefly about the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, because I think in an African Bar Association setting, it's important that we reflect on what some of these rights say regarding families. The first is Article 18, which adopts a very interesting approach. It says that the family shall be the natural unit and basis of society. It shall be protected by the state, which shall take care of its physical health and moral. So the state is being given an obligation to protect the family, both physical and moral health. And the state is given a duty to assist the family, which is a custodian of morals and traditional values recognized by the community. So not only is the state being given a duty to protect the family is being recognized as a custodian of moral values in the community. So there's a connection that has been put together between the family and moral values. And when we discuss the question of protection of the family. You can't protect the family unless you also recognize that the family is the primary vehicle through which cultural and moral values are transmitted to the members of the family who are citizens of that society, members of that society or state. So this is the first article, 18. And then very interestingly, there are two other articles that deal with the family. There is an article on duties. Duties to the family. And this is article 27. It says, every individual shall have duties towards his family and society, the state and other legally recognized communities. So people have been given duties to the family. It's not only the state from above that is being given duties to protect the family. Individuals under the African Charter are also being given duties. Article 29 says that the individual shall also have the duty to preserve the harmonious development of the family and to work for the cohesion and respect for the family, etc., etc. So the family is recognized as a subject of rights, and the duty bearer are both the individuals who belong to the family or other individuals and the state as well. This is quite interesting, and this is in keeping with that African idea that here in South Africa is called Ubuntu. I am because we are. So that is really the second aspect of this presentation on key legal instruments of marriage and the family. All the other legal instruments on rights, like the International Covenant on Elimination of Racial Discrimination, the Commission on Elimination of Discrimination, and Convention on Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, all of this says something in passing about the family. And then we've seen that there is now an emergence of international documents that are not just talking about the family, but beginning to identify some of those values which the family will be supported by, and which the family is meant to protect and promote. And some of these international documents have talked about the Vatican Charter of 1983. In 2019, during the 25th year anniversary of the International Conference on Population and Development, in Nairobi, there was a summit, and there was a declaration in the Nairobi summit that involved the need for states to protect family values. And some of the areas where family values are threatened include in areas of sexuality, because of course, you could call it the institution or the reality of sex is central to the formation of a family. In fact, the family is like an institution that clothes and protects human sexuality with dignity. So anything that undermines human sexuality ultimately harms the family. And so some of these documents are focused on certain liberal interpretations, either of what is being called a sexual and reproductive health and rights, that includes, of course, things like widespread access to abortion, legal access to abortion, issues of comprehensive sexuality education that tend to take the place for sexuality outside the family, matters to do with what has been called sexual orientation and gender identity rights that introduce a certain confusion within family relations and so on. So this document says that let the people in each nation, let the people in each community decide for themselves the values that they want to live by. And this, of course, is basically an extension or a development of this right of self-determination, which appears as Article 1 in both of the 1966 covenants, the one on civil and political rights, the one on economic, social, and cultural rights, and which was pushed by the newly independent African nations. It's a third generation right. Don't impose on us your values. When people like Bill Clinton, Tony Blair, already in the 1990s, started saying that aid to Africa is dependent on you embracing and adopting our values, If we decide we have LGBT marriage, we must have it. If we have transgender taking part in sports, we must do it in your country. If you want to engage in trade, if you want to participate in the global community. So the African countries push this idea. You can have your values, but allow us also to decide our values for ourselves. And from the 1990s until now, for a whole generation of 30 years, African countries have been having to push back against this idea that development is linked to embracing the moral, cultural, and social values of Western nations, especially. In a certain a meeting of the African Union, the president of Uganda, UN7, gave a speech in which he said, African heads of state, we are tired of receiving aid with strings attached. We are tired of being pressured to embrace foreign values. This is a new form of imperialism that has replaced the colonial experiment, in which we are not just kind of like dominating us economically, we also want to dominate us in these other methods. So some of these international declarations that I imagine are trying to emphasize, can every country be left free to decide on their stance on some of these moral and cultural values? Other examples of these documents include the 2021 Geneva Consensus Declaration, which was signed by a number of states, about 30 or 40 of them. The United States at that time was in favor of sovereignty in matters of family values. Their position changes depending on who is the president of the country. And then this year in 2023, the African Bar Association participated in a conference organized in Kampala, Uganda. It was the first inter-Africa parliamentary conference, and the topic was on sovereignty and moral values. How can African countries preserve their cultural and moral values while embracing the good things that are that come from the West or from the East, but without being forced to impose on themselves things that they consider harmful to their family values? So this is some of the documents that are relevant. So I'll talk now very quickly about this type of Kenya on family protection and promotion. A Kenyan law recognizes five kind of like personal laws on family. There is Hindu law, Islamic law, Christian law, there is African customary law, and there is also a civil law. That is, you can get married by going before government authorities. And then those laws can also be used for matters of divorce. In terms of matters to do with children, with the exception of Muslims in certain cases, there is a statutory law that supersedes all these other personal law systems. And of course, preserves certain rights of children, regardless of whether they've been born in or out of wedlock, because children are not to blame for how they came to the world, and so they should be protected into the normal issues that you find in various other countries. In Kenya, as in East Africa, we have found there's been a liberal push on matters of life and family that are characterized by Western money, Western media, and also manipulation and pressure to change the laws of our country so that they can align with the very latest social consensus in the United Kingdom, in the United States, especially on these matters of sexual and reproductive health and rights, according to the way they characterize them. And there have been three focus areas that have been particularly strong in the push against our values. That is in the area of liberal abortion, the area of what is called the gay lobby, and the area of comprehensive sexuality education. There have been several court cases that have been filed. We have a new constitution in Kenya, it's only 13 years old. And one approach has been to try and interpret the constitution as prohibiting various things that have been part of our laws and our values. And these cases have been filed to try and expand abortion through chemical drugs, abortion practitioners, to apportion tools that are the manual vacuum aspirators that are used widespread here in South Africa. There have been cases to try and allow LGBT association to strike down the laws in our penal code on LGBT and all manner of laws on issues of comprehensive sexuality education to compel our curriculum people to deal with these matters of comprehensive sexuality education and so on. One of the challenges we faced, I have personally been involved in several court cases in these topics, is the influence or impact of certain international legal instruments interpreted in a way that generally favors a liberal approach. You have the Human Rights Committee that was established under the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights of 1966. It's a liberal body that is at the UN level, and they are constantly receiving country reports, and they give comments, and they tell maybe Nigeria, we want you to legalize prostitution and pornography. They tell maybe Chile, we want you to allow LGBT marriage. They have all these kind of recommendations. And the question has arisen as to whether the recommendations of this committee can be considered part of international law. In the case of Kenya and a number of other countries, the courts have eventually determined that no, these are just comments, that international law is made up of two things. Of course, we know the conventions, that is the treaties or agreements, and second, customary international law is widely accepted international norms, or generally accepted international norms that have gained that concrete status of being international law. So this has been one of the areas. And in the case of Africa, to be precise, the Maputo Protocol, which is on the rights of women, which was passed in 2003 as an annex to the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, has one or two articles, in particular Article 14, that deals with matters of abortion that has been pushed in Kenya and in East Africa for our countries to interpret it as allowing abortion on demand or abortion on request. And in the case of Kenya and several other countries that ratified the Maputo Protocol, reservations were made to Article 14, and this has been an issue that has been debated in the courts. There have also been issues of interconnectedness of decisions in various African countries. When something happens in Malawi or in Zambia, that case will be cited as a precedent in Tanzania, in Uganda, in Kenya. And there is a common legal tradition. In East Africa, we even have common law reports. In the old days, we had a common East African Court of Appeal, which was disbanded. So we've noted that in matters of protecting family values, it's not enough to protect your own family. As you protect your family, if other families are having problems, if you protect family law in your country and other countries are having problems with their family laws, then they tend to influence all the neighboring countries. And sometimes the strategy of Western media and money is to target vulnerable nations within Africa and establish precedents that can then be copied in other parts of the continent. So there's been a lot of litigation, and Nigeria and Uganda have recently passed laws prohibiting certain very kind of like aggressive push for homosexuality in their countries. There's been a lot of pushback from the West. But these are some of the things that are happening as a reaction on family values. And the last thing I want to talk about, because my time is almost up, is I want to talk about the Entebbe Declaration, which was done early this year as a foundational document for a fresh Africa-wide approach that emphasizes values as part of the content of human rights. Human rights are a content, but the values that accompany human rights tend to be the libertarian, liberal, individualistic values from the Western philosophy. And we are proposing that this needs to be supplemented, especially for us who understand African jurisprudence, with an African
peculiar understanding of the individual and the community. That human rights are both an individual and a communitarian dimension, and that the element of community which arises from that concept of Ubuntu is very important. That human dignity is not just about being the possessor of rights, but also, as the African Charter of Human and People's Rights demonstrates, as also someone who has duties that they have to comply with or to correspond to. Duties to the family, to the society, the community, and the state. And then we also propose that this African jurisprudence that is founded on the basic concept of Ubuntu should have three core pillars, which are like the three legs of the traditional African stool. And these pillars is the idea of community, the idea of dignity, that is not just a pleasure or individual kind of like satisfaction without concern for the community, and thirdly, the concept of responsibility and reconciliation. The family can be the subject of human rights, and all of us as lawyers, as we engage in family law, we can reflect, does my interaction, intervention in family law matters contribute to the welfare and well-being of the family? Am I just a family law practitioner whose job is to break up families? Do I have moments when I engage on how to strengthen the African family? And the insistence on this African-led emphasis on third generation human rights of peoples, including the right of self-determination, the right to economic and social development, and maintaining our values, will actually add the richness to the modern African family and probably contribute to that family meeting those goals, the mission and vision of the family to contribute to the well-being of all the members there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Charles. This at this point of time we would like to dialogue with the panelists. Any questions to raise, if you have a comment to make. I'd like to acknowledge the presence among us of the judges, members of the armed forces. Thank you very much for being around. Matters of security sometimes are misunderstood and left at the level of the hardware. The family and the moral values and cultural values of the software of the community, if they are undermined, the sovereignty of the state would actually be undermined. So I'll take a few questions and comments to our panelists. I'll start from the extreme end. Do we have any roving mic? Okay. Right there.
Thank you, distinguished panelists, for that very informative presentation. Senior Counsel, if I heard you right a couple of days ago, you said that we need to hear both sides of the argument. But I think you may agree with me that this afternoon we've heard only one side of the argument and be dodging the bullet. In my view, the elephant in the room are same-sex marriages. But I don't have a problem with that because I know where we can get to. My question is, with regards to protection of the family, and specifically taking a look at the African Charter of Human People's Rights and the Rights of the Child Convention, where or how can we locate the voice or the choice of the child when it comes to them being adopted by the same-sex couples? Number two, in the military, though it's not really an issue of debate so far, but we have an undercurrent whereby people of sexual orientation that may be queer will be not welcome in our militaries. The position that it is, that is there at the moment, that is subsisting, is akin to what happened United States where you don't say, you don't tell. So what would be your guidance with regards to that person when it comes to the media? Thank you.
We'll take another from this way. Yeah. Is there a question up there? My eyes tend to be locked here. Okay.
Thank you as well to the panelists for that thought-provoking presentation. I wanted to find out from Kenyon Shaka from Zambia. Thank you. I wanted to find out from both Namibia and Kenya why a constitutional definition for both family and marriage has been quite elusive, even in the case of Namibia, where even after a court case that you had, you made an amendment to a subsidiary legislation but didn't touch the constitution. And then secondly, as senior counsel, is there any value to the mention of the word family in the preamble of the constitution? Or what value would that have in case there's challenge to its definition? Thank you.
Okay, we then come to the the lady first before we move this call.
Thank you very much, Member from Cameroon. I would just like to ask the panelists, what is the relationship between after and family, and what is the position of after and family? Okay. Okay, just to have somebody else asking that, based on the theme of this conference, I would like to know the relationship between after the family, or what's the position of the family in after. Because I know the fact that there's people who are actually specializing in family law and family related issues, and we want to know the benefits of that from a conference like this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chairperson from Cameroon. Oh, I wish to find out about money issue of gay marriages and values. We already know that about 16 countries or so have already ratified their laws and they have legalized the issue of gay marriages and the rest.
16 countries
or so
legalized,
yes, and some are silent about it, which means whether their citizens are practicing or not, or they are not, it's just okay, or maybe not. So we should find out what lawyers can do to prevent their own countries for carrying out constitutional reforms that would stop, or for carrying out constitutional reforms that would promote the practice of the treaty.
I didn't get the question.
What can lawyers do to protect their countries from the emerging amendments and pressures coming of their laws? Alright,
then Sonny. Okay, before Sonny, let's have the gentleman there. Sonny, I'd like you to speak last. Let the gentleman speak. Thank you very much. Yesterday, after Dr. Made his presentation, there was a clarification that was given, I think, by the moderator or so. by the fact that the position as was presented by the doctor is not the stance of AFTA. Sorry, it's not the stance of AFBA. So I want to ask, does AFBA has a position on the stance to preservation of family values vis-a-vis the influence of LGBTQ plus and the activism we have that? If there's no such stance, can AFBA have a proper legal stance on this issue? But I understand there is a committee of AFBA that is set up to address human rights related issues from this nation. And so it's good that there's an established stance for the committee to have a framework for which to support it. Thank you.
Luckily, we have the president in the room. I think he stays around long enough to clarify that. We also have the CEO in that setting. So we'll have a response.
My name is Professor Investor. I just wanted to make a small comment. First of all, let me thank the speakers, the parliament, and I've done a very good job. And all I want to ask them to try to help to come to this session. And some of them will say, well, this thing of marriage is a very private thing. No, it's not a private thing. As a link between that and the family, the national building. You have to tell people that, well, it's my own business, I don't have anything. No, no, there is. Because if the family is destroyed, the whole nation is destroyed. If the family is threatened, the whole Africa is a struggle. But you don't have to go home for the air, the problem of the family. That's the problem. Lawyers who are here, if your wife is going to put you for you, you go out to work to perform well. So there's a link. And it's not a religious thing, really. It's a national question. That's why in Nigeria, there's a family, a section of the family, center of the family. I'm sure that's what I'm talking. Second, part of the thing that I do, I'm a part of the delegation of Nigeria to the United Nations, and I go to the United Nations every year. I will tell you that it is baffling that all attempts is made to compromise the family, as the parents have said, by using euphemism. That's why when you go back to your own country, you know, these law duties and duties are brought back to country for certification and for ratification. My job in Nigeria has been to look at the documents and say, look,
whatever.
They are not important. The first is culture. I mean, this is what we learn. Okay, that's what
I'm saying. Thank you. Point.
Now, I'll need a paper to.
Now, good people, we have some documents here, in case you're interested. The lady Shogila is around, the student. You could pick a copy of them. The document will be spoken about later. I'd like that microphone to go to that lady first before we get to the questions, so that the dialogue is inclusive. There was a lady taking your details in case you want the cited documents shared with you in soft copy, you would have them.
Good afternoon, my name is Dr. Molly Tom. I'm the director of the special projects in the office of the Vice Chancellor and Minister of South Africa. However, I'm speaking on my own behalf. I'm not speaking on behalf of UNISA. I'm not speaking on behalf of the Vice Chancellor. My question is international goal, fundamentally human rights goal. And let me say upfront that I am a Christian and I have no sense of doubt or sense of contradiction about both being a Christian, believing God, believing Jesus, and being a human rights lawyer. And in fact, I do find a very strong correlation between Christian values and human rights law. It always astounds me when I hear people, when they start to talk about gender equality, speak about it as if it's anti-Christian and it's anti-human rights or it's anti-cultural laws. As I said, my own study PhD is human rights law. I have worked in the human rights field for several years, and that includes being deputy director and acting director of the Center for Human Rights at the University of Pretoria here in South Africa. I've worked as a research student for the first United Nations Special Rapporteur on Indigenous Rights, Rights of Indigenous Peoples. In that work, we have traveled to countries such as Kenya, Tanzania, Botswana, and others, advocating for the rights, economic, social, and cultural rights of Indigenous peoples. Now, what many of the participants don't know is that today, in fact, Nine August in South Africa is a public holiday. It's a public holiday where you celebrate as a nation the rights of women. Our constitution is founded on the values of equality, human dignity, and respect for all human beings. Our constitution is grounded very, very strongly on the rights of the individual to equality and the rights of women. The reason why we celebrate 9 August in South Africa is because on 9 August 1956, a number of women marched to the Union buildings in South Africa State House to march against the oppression of women. Those who know would know that Nelson Mandela was one of the strongest proponents of supporting the rights of women. He said, a nation will never be truly free until it sets its women free and supports their rights. Now, there's an interesting point about research that's been conducted for several years that shows that, in fact, gender equality is for the good of all humankind. McKinsey Global Institute has run studies over several years. Where this particular study I'd like to refer to is one where they say and they talk about and they show empirically that in fact nations that have higher levels of gender equality do much better than those that have not, that don't do so. They show through studies that when you have gender parity, and there's a distinction between gender parity and gender equality. When you have gender parity, in other words, you have the same number of young girls and young boys entering school. You give them the same rights. You have the same rights, labor rights, for men and women entering the labor force. That stands for the power of parity. They started on a global level and then went continentally. They have started in Africa, they have started on Asia, they have started on Western Europe, they have started on North America and South America and Australia separately. And this is what the studies have shown. When you have gender parity in any nation, there's a higher increase in the quality of life of those citizens. And the reason is quite simple. Women look after children. Women raise families. Women are the people that hold the family together. When you give them more rights, you are actually empowering the entire society.
Okay, thank you very much. You've made a point. It would seem that the critique of Mr. Soni, the FOC, on the question of gender equality, could have been misread to mean the dismissal of the concept of equality between men and women. But I understood Mr. Soni as saying that gender is no longer an innocent term. The term gender these days means more than what we've always known as men and women. So the question of equality widens the whole scope there. That is for the panelists really to respond to the questions and comments. So please go ahead, Charles. And,
basically to just add on what you were saying, there is definitely a lot of correlation between Christianity and human rights. Human rights is confronting by just being human. I think the danger that we are facing right now is the interpretation of human rights and including different values that are not African values and expanding it as human rights. And that is what Africa needs to protect itself from. What is human rights in an African context? Is it the same as in European context? That's obviously a discussion on its own. But we see more and more an invasion of human rights from a completely different value-based disposition that is being imposed on Africa. Let me perhaps just speak on the importance of family and its relations to trade. Why is it so important that we protect the family in the discussion of the African free trade? You cannot trade efficiently and effectively if your security is not sound. And so family provides that security for any nation. And if a family, if the stability of a nation is not founded upon the stability of a family, a nation is compromised. And so in ensuring that our free trade and the discussions that we are having, takes place within an environment of stability, security, and safety, we cannot shy away from the importance that family plays in providing stability, security, as well as safety for any human nation. It is obvious that there is no human being that operates in silo. You come from a family, and you can only be as strong as the family is, and a society can only be as strong as a family is, and therefore a nation is only as strong as the society is. Just to provide some background in terms of why Namibia did not just go ahead and amend its constitution. Obviously, it is not easy to amend a constitution. And so the approach that Namibia has taken in ensuring that the interpretation of our courts is consistent with the social and historical background of the formulation and development of our constitution is by enacting a law that explicitly explains the background and background of our constitution in terms of its social and historical background. There are obviously attempts currently to rather have a referendum that would then state what Namibia stands for, that would then supplement what the constitution is saying, but obviously that has financial implications. And the reasoning behind this is to say, why should Namibia use financial resources on a matter that the Namibians are very clear on what their stance are? And so we rather would redirect our financial resources to matters of more importance and inject our financial resources on that and use the opinions and values and remarks of the Namibian people as have been shown through different public interest platforms that shows what the Namibian stance is on same-sex marriages. Coming on to basically just to conclude in terms of the Namibian story, yes, we too are facing so many threats, but the major threat is exactly the issue of same-sex marriages on our families as well as abortion. And so the role that lawyers played in this regard was to be vocal and to educate and create awareness within the nation in terms of what the laws of Namibia are, as well as the constitution of Namibia. And in answering one of the audience that asked what role lawyers could play, it's exactly in addition to that, creating awareness on the importance of family laws as well as the values and entrenched within the Namibian people. Let me end there.
Thank you, Charles.
Thank you for those questions. I think they were very useful questions and contributions. I will attempt a preliminary response, not a comprehensive one, because this is topics that require ongoing discussion and dialogue. And the answer is not with me, but with all of us through dialogue. The first question was about the two sides of the argument. Actually, they're not just two sides. There are many sides of the argument. As lawyers, every time you go to court, if it is an adversarial system, you take the position of one party. But we know that those lawyers who handle cases involving the child, there's a general principle that the rights of the child are of paramount importance. And if your client is pushing an agenda that is harmful to the rights of the child, legal ethics requires us to decline to advance such a position. So this is like the one exception where the interests of your client will not supersede the interests of another party who's involved in the litigation. There may be other exceptions. What I'm trying to say is that in this case of family, there are not just two sides to the story. Many times there are several sides. There's a side of the parents, there's a side of the unwitting children who often are caught up in the affairs of their parents and suffer sometimes the most harm. So on the question of the voice of the child in same-sex adoption, this is an issue that is fraught with a lot of public policy considerations. If you are in an African country which, as a matter of public policy, does not allow same-sex relations or behavior, then naturally, same-sex adoption will not be allowed because it contravenes public policy. If you're in a country like South Africa, where same-sex relations are allowed, then a different set of criteria come into play in terms of what is in the best interest of the child. There have been many studies, and this is a multidisciplinary approach that includes economists, sociologists, psychologists, and so on, to determine what is in the best interest of the child.
The pastor who asked the question is right, that the child often doesn't get to give their view of the matter. What I can see is that a large number of social studies have concluded that the welfare of the child is ordinarily best served if they have both a father and a mother who protect and care for them. And the Convention on the Rights of the Child recognizes the same thing. But this is a debate that in some of the Western countries has been resolved in favor of the rights of the parents with the less regard for the interests of the child. And there was a question of, in the military, what approach should be followed. And again, I think this depends on what is the position of this particular nation or country on this issue of same-sex relations and marriage. The second question was by Chapo, for example, on why has the constitutional definition for family and marriage been elusive? And I think it is because, one, it's something which when you see it, you can recognize it. It is so obvious to us that sometimes we don't take an effort to define it. And second, it's because there are so many variations and sometimes differences in perspective that the effort to define family has not been undertaken effectively, apart from just saying it's a natural and fundamental unit of society, and then discussing different kinds of marriages or family situations. I think it is a definition that we need to begin to make in our legal instruments. Is there any value to mention of the family in the preamble to our constitution? Yes, there is. The family is mentioned in important legal instruments, including the African Charter of Human and People's Rights, and it does make sense. In a preamble, you get the kind of like principles or philosophy that is used to interpret the entire constitutional document. In the case of the Kenyan constitution, we have a preamble with 8 paragraphs, and the 5th paragraph, which is the committed clauses, committed to kind of like securing the welfare of individuals, families, communities, and the nation. And I like this approach where it is recognized that our legal instruments are for the benefit of us as individuals, and then when we come together in the natural institution of the family, in communities, and in the nation as well. And the next question was, is there a relationship between this treaty that we've been discussing in this conference, the AFTA treaty, the African Free Continental Trade Area Treaty, and the family? And I'll answer by saying two things. One, the word family does not appear even once in that treaty. So it would be simple to say that this treaty has ignored the family. And I think the approach that matters of trade should not be made dependent on social or cultural values, which is an approach that the African countries took in the third generation rights when they said that the right to economic and social development of our people should not be made dependent on values of a certain group or another group. Each party should be allowed to develop without having strings attached. And also the third generation right of self-determination, that each nation should determine its values for itself. So at first glance, it appears as if AFTA has nothing to say about the family. But AFTA mentions social and welfare a few times, 3 or 4 times. And the family is implicitly included in that idea in both the protocol on services and the protocol on goods, that we should trade for the purpose of benefiting the welfare of the peoples of these African countries. And I think that includes the family. There was a question about some countries that have legalized gay marriage. What can lawyers do if in your country you do not want to legalize gay marriage and it is being introduced because of questions of recognition? We've seen what some Western countries have done, because there's no unanimity even in the West or in the East. So this is an issue which is left for each country to sovereignly determine. There are some countries which will choose to recognize marriages entered into elsewhere, but the majority of the countries that don't recognize gay marriages, they use the approach that if that marriage you entered into would not have been legal in our country, then we cannot recognize it. So foreign marriages are recognized ordinarily if they would have been legal in the country of that is being asked to recognize if they had been entered in that particular country. And that seems to be a reasonable approach. And of course, in regard to constitutional reforms, the most important approach for lawyers is to educate themselves and to participate in all those constitutional making and reform processes. There was a question about the stance of AfBA on issues of LGBT, and from my knowledge, AfBA has not taken a position one way or the other. And there are several countries in Africa. Majority of the countries in Africa are still not friendly to expansion of gay agenda or gay behavior in their countries. There are few countries, however, that have the opposite approach. But what I believe is the stance that has been taken in the Entebbe consensus document, which AfBA was part of, was to say that there is resistance, or African countries should resist foreign imposition of values. And this is the same approach, you could say the anti-colonial approach of the African Union that is also shared by AfBA, I believe, which is a self-determination. Let each country, each community decide for themselves how they want to live their affairs in matters of family, so long as they do not fundamentally harm individual rights as well as individual welfare. On the question, there was a comment by Sonny about culture being the kind of like a barrier to protect. Okay, so I think I will just say that in Kiswahili, which is an African language spoken in East Africa widely, there is a saying, Mwacha mila ni mtumwa, which means the person who abandons their culture is a slave or a serf or a servant. And I'm saying that to support the comments by Sonny that cultural values have been recognized in Africa as very important to our identity as a people, and they should be instilled even in our discourse about human rights. And finally, there was a comment about the importance of gender equality by Dr. I think it was for the talk from UNISA, and I think I agree fully that equality of men and women is a consensus position in numerous international human rights instruments, in most countries' laws, and it is something that we should support and protect. And the question or the concern is where, in addition to men and women, there's a question of whether gender should be extended to 3, 4, 5 or multiple other gender identities and manifestations and so on. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's a clap for our panelists once again, and a clap for ourselves. Now, the document in your hands is the first Inter-Parliamentary Assembly or Conference on Family Values and Sovereignty. We people, no matter what we do, the imposition of values other than African values is touching on African sovereignty. We invite you to consider that document. The Family Committee would wish that the African Bar Association members and participants to this conference address themselves to the issues and contestations raised in this declaration and probably figure out how we can forge forward an Africa-wide instrument that protects African values, protects the African culture and the sovereignty of the African states. I'll now invite the president or Mr. Fudi to come and do the final ritual of thanking our panelists. You're welcome.
monitor. So when you see AfBA doesn't have a stand, that's not correct. The African Bar has a stand. But the African Bar is not interested in whether you are gay or whatever, you join the African Bar. But in terms of subscribing to the African values, and what our leaders subscribe to, yes, you understand. And that's really putting very clear. We don't have anything against the LGBT people or whatever. But we do not support the counter-speak approach of we've got something there to you unless you do this. That's bullshit. I don't accept that. So the African Bar doesn't accept that. So that's our stance. Let's say we don't accept that. So I'd like to invite Jonas of the Conference of Cote d'Ivoire to help us with the presentation. Thank you everybody for your participation at this session. The conference is gathered down tomorrow. All the sessions will take place at 12, but the important session will be the rule of law session. What time? Thank you.